गणपतिगुं हवामहे कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रृण्वन्मूतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानामालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशङ्करं लोकशङ्करं सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः। 15th मंत्र। अशब्दमस्पर्शमरूपमव्ययम् तथा रसं नित्यमगन्धवच्छयत् अनाद्यनन्तं महतः परं ध्रुवम् निचाय्यतं मृत्युमुखात् प्रमुच्यते। अनाद्यनन्तम्, दिस आत्मा इज अनादि, इट हैज नो बिगिनिंग। यू सी अमोंग कारणा एंड कार्य, कार्य हैज ए बिगिनिंग, सो कार्य कैन ऑल्सो बी कॉल्ड एज सादि एंड कारणम इज नॉट सादि बिकॉज इट वॉज देर इन द बिगिनिंग, बिगिनिंग ऑफ द कार्य। सपोज पॉट इज क्रिएटेड, पॉट इज बोर्न एंड नाउ पॉट इज कंटिन्यूइंग, विथ रेफरेंस टू पॉट देर इज अ स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट, बट ट्रे हैज नॉट स्टार्टेड वेन पॉट हैज अ स्टार्टेड, देयरफॉर पॉट हैज अ, यू कैन कॉल इट सादि, बट क्ले इज नॉट सादि विथ रेफरेंस टू पॉट। बट वेन यू टेक द क्ले इटसेल्फ, द पृथ्वी, पृथ्वी इटसेल्फ इज बोर्न एट ए डेट, देयरफॉर इट इज हैविंग सादि, it is also, it is having an adi, therefore it also can be called as a sadi. What is the karanam for prithvi? Abhya prithvi. So what else? We have seen the sequence of panchabhutas, five elements, therefore like that for everything there is a cause. So this ladder of upward ladder of karya karana bhava, so take a karyam, what is its cause? Karanam. That karanam has a cause once again. It itself is a karyam. Therefore, it's a karanam. Like that, if you go, it will stop. It should stop at a point. That point is atma or brahma. So, that is what is called sarva karana karanam. It is the cause of all causes. It is also called parama karanam, the supreme cause. Beyond that, there is nothing else. So such a thing is called anadi. So anadi, atma or brahma is anadi. Anantam, again it is not having an anta. If you talk in the same language, adi is karyam, therefore anadi is the parama karanam. If you continue the same perspective, then anantam means it doesn't have a karyam, it doesn't have a karanam for itself, there is nothing karanam beyond for itself, so it is anadi, and it doesn't have a karyam also. How? Suppose you take a ball of clay, now you make it into pot, now ball of clay is not available. What happened to the ball of clay? It is exhausted. How? Because it is modified into a effect, a product, karyam. So that kind of a modification is not there for atma. When you take a ball of clay and create a pot, it is a vikara, it is also called parinama. Parinama means a transformation. The causation is of two kinds, transformational causation and apparitional causation. So let me note down those two very important points. So karana,
Karana is the cause. It is twofold.
One is a parinami. Parinami karana. Parinami karana means transformational cause. Transformational cause. Another is vivarta karana. Vivarta means apparitional cause. Vivarta, it is apparitional cause. We define like that initially. Later we convert karana karya bhavam into mithya. Just the initial stages of teaching we define like, we don't mind defining like that. You see, a ball of clay is there. Now it is converted into pot. What pot is karyam? What is the karanam ball of clay? What kind of karanam it is? It is called a transformational cause because the ball of clay is transformed. It is called parinama. Means it is having certain shape or form. That form is changed. There is a visible, clear-cut change in the form. That is what is called parinama. So parinami means one which undergoes parinama is called parinami. Therefore, the ball of clay is parinami karanam. You can separate it like that. That is parinami karanam, one kind of a cause. So, for pot, what is the cause? Clay. What kind of a cause? Parinami karanam. Now, this universe is there. For this universe, Brahma is the karanam. Right? What kind of karanam? They say parinami karanam. Some people say that. I tell you, any possibility is there, there is always a guy which he takes up that possibility. Anything, if you can swim Atlantic, then there is somebody who wants to swim it. If you can jump down Niagara, then there is always a guy who wants to do it. Very interesting world it is. Therefore, when two causes are possible, there is always a guy who takes up one of them. You see, there is always a person who climbs the wrong tree. Always there is one person. So this parinama karanavadi, they are like that. They say the jagat is a transformation of Ishvara. How it can be possible? Suppose Ishvara is transformed into jagat, then that means what happens, you know, jagat becomes real. And there will be no Ishvara now. Ishvara should have been exhausted. Or at least a part of Ishvara should have been exhausted. It's like a big mound of clay is there and you have made a few parts. So half of the clay is consumed. Now that mound of clay will not appear complete. There is a big gap or a big hole is made in that mound of clay. Because you have removed a part of the clay. Therefore, if Ishvara is transformed into this universe, then Ishvara must have been consumed by the formation of this universe. There must have been a big hole or a big chunk of Ishvara must have gone away. Therefore, Ishvara might be in very deep trouble now because a deep chunk of Ishvara is now in the form of this universe. So suppose a lady has to make chapatis. If atta is available separately, she will make it. Suppose she has to make chapati from her own flesh, will she make it? She will not make it because the more chapatis are made, she will be reducing in size. You know, nobody will do that kind of a silly thing. Why Ishvara should do that kind of a thing? Therefore, Ishvara is the transformational cause of this universe. That doesn't stand. Then what kind of a cause he is? He is an apparitional cause. I tell you, there is a cinema is there. On the cinema screen, there are so many figures have come. dance, etc. Hero and heroine dance, this is normally what I say. So, so many characters are there on the screen. They were not there earlier. Now they are there. So they will not be there later. So they are there, they have come there. So you explain that karana karya bhava, the cause-effect relationship. The figures and characters that are appearing on the screen are the effects. What is the cause and what kind of cause it is? You have to necessarily say the cause is light, the projector light. You can define the cause like this, yad bhave tad bhavaha, yad abhave tad abhavaha. On that basis, this is what is called anvayana vyatireka. By, if you have the light, the projector lamp is there, you have the cinema. Yad bhave tad bhavaha. In case the projector lamp is spoiled, it is fused, suppose, you don't have the cinema, right? So, film is there, but the lamp is necessary. If the lamp is there is picture. There is no lamp, there is no picture. That means what? Which is the cause of the picture? The light is the cause of the picture. So karana is established. Then what kind of karana it is? Is it a transformational causation? No, absolutely not. It is not a transformation of light. Therefore, you cannot say light has undergone a transformation to give all these pictures. No. Then what kind of a cause it is? Apparitional. That means pictures are appearing. So you cannot say pictures are born. You have to say pictures have appeared, are appearing. Only that much you have to say. Apparitional. It has, the word has come from appear. So there is a rope and a snake is seen on it. A snake, you have seen a snake. In fact, you say there is a snake. You don't say, I see a snake there. You don't say that. If you say that, you are a Viveki only. You don't say that. What you say? There is a snake. So, you have seen a snake there. In fact, you concluded there is a snake. Okay. Now, this snake, what is the cause of this snake? Where from it has come? You cannot say a snake has come out of an egg or any such thing. That a snake... eggs of the snake, one of them has been hatched and the snake come out of it. You cannot say that. Because the snake has come out of the rope. Because later you found that the rope is what is there. Therefore the snake which was seen by you, from where it has come? From rope it has come. So what kind of a relationship between karana and karya here? Is it that the rope is transformed into the snake? No. Rope has become the locus for the appearance of the snake. That's it. Similarly, prakasha, light has become the locus for the appearance of cinema. Similarly, atma or ishvara is the locus in which this jagat appears. Suppose I tell you how it is. You see a friend or a foe. What is this friend or a foe? It is a thought frame. We come back to our thought frame. Now what is this thought frame, foe thought frame or friend thought frame? What it is? It is a wave-like situation in the ocean of consciousness, Atma Chaitanyam. Therefore, what is the cause from where this foe has come or friend has come? From the Atma Chaitanyam, the friend or foe has come. Now, how it has come? Is it apparitional or is it transformation? Is it that the Atma Chaitanyam is undergoing transformation to become foe or friend? No, absolutely not. You can easily understand that it is not the transformational causation. Without Atma Chaitanyam, there is neither friend nor foe. But Atma Chaitanyam is not the parinami karanam. That means, in the Atma Chaitanyam, you are seeing a friend or foe. Therefore, Atma Chaitanyam is the vivarta karanam, the apparitional cause for the appearance of friend or foe. Therefore, now you should change the language. The language is karana karya bhavam is mithya. When we use the word parinami karanam or transformational causation, there karana karya bhavam is taken to be real. Whereas in the apparitional causation, it just appearance only. Therefore, the causation is no more real. Karyam is mithya. Therefore, karanatvam is mithya. Karanam is not mithya. Karanam is real. But the karanatvam, the status of being the cause, is mithya. Because when karyam is mithya, karanatvam, the status of being the cause, is mithya. Therefore, the adhisthanam, whenever you have a mithya, automatically the adhisthanam has to be understood. Otherwise, there is no mithya. Therefore, the hero on the screen is mithya. Then what is the truth? The light. The snake that is seen now is mithya. Then what is the reality? Rope. The jagat is mithya. Then what is the reality? Brahma. So are the appearances of the world are mithya. Then what is the reality? Atma Chaitanyam. So Atma Chaitanyam becomes responsible for various things to appear or spring before you, but it itself doesn't undergo any transformation. That is what is called anantam, anadyanantam. So that is how Bhashyakara has presented it very nicely. Anadyanantam mahataha param. Anantam Bhashyakara says, if the karana karya bhava is real, then by the time karya is born, karana is gone. He gives the example of a banana tree. By the time a bunch of fruits have come, the original tree is gone. So similarly, if you say karana karya bhava between Brahma and Jagat is real, then by the time Jagat appears, Brahma is gone. That kind of a thing is not there. That is the meaning of anantam. Then what? And secondly, anantam nityam. Nityam is already there. Anadyanantam, therefore nityam. Nityam is above. So you can combine like that. You can club those adjectives. Anadi anantam, it has no cause and no real effect comes out of it. That is the meaning of anadi anantam, which we have seen. Therefore nityam, it is eternal. Kutastha nityam, that we have seen. You see, this you have to understand. Atma is nityam. You know what happens? The logic that you come across in the world is, you see, come on, let us enjoy. Because this young age is anityam. Therefore, let us enjoy. You see, you hold on to anitya. Anitya means temporary or transient. You hold on to anityatmam. And because of holding on to the anitya, and you don't have the nitya concept, so the conclusion is, let us make merry. That is the conclusion. I told you, I suppose, I heard a song. The song is very, very absorbing music and all that, but the song is, song means, kal kya hoga kaun dekhe, aao levo maja, something of that kind of a song. That means tomorrow what happens, who knows, therefore come and enjoy. So anityatvam is understood, right? But when you have an anitya, an impermanent thing, a transient thing, a coming and going thing, you should also understand the locus of that anitya, the adhisthanam of the anitya. If you don't understand the nitya atma, then what happens? You end up in such kind of conclusions. But suppose you say, oh, this happened, these pleasures, etc., they come and go. This age also is very much ephemeral, it will be changing continuously. But all these changes are taking place on the locus of the nitya atma. Suppose you say that, then you will be striving to know that atma. Therefore, in this world, we should not only have the knowledge of anitya, we should also have the knowledge of nitya. Otherwise, you will end up in a wrong route. Therefore, Mahatma say, this anityatvam concept, which is very much there in the loka, they utilize that concept to grab you, to drag you rather, into the sense pleasures. So you couple this nitya vastu. It is anityam, to that extent it's all right. At the same time, Atma, that is you are the nitya vastu, you are the nitya swarupa. So you should never be under the impression, oh, I am anitya, therefore let me make merry. That kind of a conclusion is wrong. You are not anitya, you are the nitya vastu. Anadyanantam mahatah param. Then mahat is samashti buddhi. I told you, indriyebhya parah yathah, arthebhyascha param manah. You take basically, fundamentally you take these things, the various bhogas that are there. And the indriyas which enjoy those bhogas, one unit. But the mind is the real seat of all enjoyment, not the indriya alone. So suppose you see an object, a beautiful object, what is the seat of enjoyment, what is the locus of enjoyment? It's a thing of beauty, is a joy forever. That is what the poet Keats says. Okay, it is joy all right, but joy where? Is the joy in the flower itself? A rose is a beautiful thing. Is it a property of the flower? No. Then joy, is it in the eyes which see the flower? No. The joy happens in the mind. Mind is the locus. At least superficially, mind is the locus. If you analyze a little more, it goes to Atma, all right. But that is what we are really doing also. So, bhoga or beauty or whatever, and indriyas, all put together one unit. But more subtle than them, and more subtle and more pratyak. More pratyak, more inner to you, more nearer to you, that is manah. Then, manasastu parabuddhi. The buddhi, which is the seat of all samskaras, from where alone all these emotions are springing up in the form of thought frames, that buddhi, that is superior to manah. That buddhi is not an isolated buddhi. It is one Hiranyagarbha buddhi really. That's why sometimes different minds can interact with each other. This is what is called clairvoyance or some such thing they call it. I suppose that is the word they use, clairvoyance. So that means I can read your mind or I can see things at a distance. So that means what? Like even you have electromagnetic radiations and the gravitational radiations, they say gravitational waves are there. So similarly, gravitation is energy, therefore it must be available in this form of some energy or the other. Similarly, the thought process is also an expression of energy. Each thought frame is an energy. That's why your mind works well after you take lunch, provided you don't get sleep generally. Suppose you are on fast. Suppose I keep fast for a full day. Next day morning you ask me to teach Kathopanishad. I may make up some energy and try to speak. I may be able to speak all right, but my mind won't function. Mind refuses to remember anything. Then you go and have some breakfast and coffee and then come back, mind functions. It means what? So the thought processes are all expressions of energy, a particular form of energy. Like even sound is energy, light is energy, gravitation is energy, even thought is energy. Thought wave, it is energy, it is. Therefore, hence you have a thing called thought wave. These thought waves, they just don't sit here only, they are all over the place. In fact, we are going to have a word called Brahma Samsadhi, it is coming. So, suppose this room is there, this temple is there. We may leave this place and go elsewhere, some wonderful air-conditioned hall in Manhattan, and take class there. Why not? We may do it, nothing wrong, but this place has got a sanctity. What is this sanctity? We say that sanctity, that's why we have a temple and a place to teach. Sanctified place. What do you mean by sanctity? Sanctity means in this place, those thought waves are there. They are there in this place. So anybody who comes into this hall, his mind automatically assumes a very special a purified status, a particular phase it will gain. It goes into a particular phase, a higher level of a purified state it goes into. So because the mind is influenced by all the thoughts that are around the place and then the company. Suppose you sit in the club and then start studying Gita, etc. Once what happened, you know, there was a club was there, and they invited me for Gita talk. They told it's a cultural program. Cultural program is a very misleading word. They do recording dance and all that in the name of cultural program. But anyway, I was misled. So they invited me to give a talk on Gita. So I thought maybe it's a good place. I asked a few questions, but they did not answer me properly. They have put some pressure upon me. So somehow they dragged me into it. Then finally I went there. They took me there and I found myself in the club. I was in the club. And then I also noticed that some alcoholic beverages were available there. And must be, if I pursue the thing, if I make some investigation, some non-veg food also might have been available there. Then suddenly I went there. I was unable to, I was like a tube light. You know, tube light takes a little time to come into light. So I was wondering what is going on, what should I do. I accepted an invitation and came. Then suddenly they invited me onto this stage. I went onto this stage because they called me and somebody took me to this stage. Then they asked, now so and so will teach on Gita. I refused to speak. I did not speak. Then I asked, is it a club? Yes. What is that? It's a bar. I will not speak on Gita here. Why? This is our cultural program. We are inviting all types of people, including religious people. I told you, you made a mistake. You should have told me. I refuse to speak. Because I will not speak in a club. The reason is the atmosphere there, the people who are sitting there, their attitude and their approach towards the teaching is all wrong. And in that place, if I teach Bhagavan's words, in fact, I don't get the mood to teach in the first place. My mouth will be shut. I will not be able to utter any words. I may say a shlokam, but then I will not be able to explain it. I am at a loss. That is number one. Number two, they will be sitting it and they will not be benefited by it. Because I am speaking, somebody in the middle will go and get a little alcohol and come and sit there and start listening to my talk also. They will do it. So I refuse to speak. If the program is cancelled, let it be cancelled. I will not speak. So why I told you this? The place are having the thought waves. So don't think that your thoughts are exclusive to you. No, they are not exclusive to you. Nothing is exclusive in this universe. In the house, some very good atmosphere is there in the house, suppose. Some puja graham is there, every day you do puja, and some photographs, etc., of Lord Krishna, etc., are there, and Satpurusha, Sadhus, Sadhana, Sant, they come and go. In that kind of a house, you have a very sanctified environment. On the other hand, there is not a single photograph to make your mind remember Ishvara, and not a single day puja is done, and no Sadhu Sant has come to that house. Only friends come and play cards and go away. Into that kind of a house, the environment also is affected. Why I am saying all this? Your buddhi is influenced by the all thought waves around it. Because all buddhis are connected. Don't think that one buddhi is isolated. There is no isolated buddhi at all. All the buddhi is an energy. Is there an isolated energy anywhere? Your body is emitting radiations to the outside world and heat is coming into your body from the outside world. You are not isolated at any point of time. It is one continuation. In this universe, everything is a continuation. Therefore, your buddhi is in consonance or in contact with millions and millions of other buddhis. So if you take Hiranyagarbha, so just go to the level of Hiranyagarbha. I want you to take to that level. That is my effort. Therefore, you are interacting with the Hiranyagarbha buddhi. Your buddhi is a part of the Hiranyagarbha. Therefore, now you can say that individual buddhi, Vyashti buddhi, is inferior and the Hiranyagarbha buddhi is superior. That is Maha. Mahatah Param. Mahatah Param is Atma Brahma. Brahma is superior to Mahan. We have a sequence of creation. Brahma, Maya Shakti, Mahatattvam. So that is the
creation. In your own meditation, when your mind is resolved into the buddhi, and buddhi itself, in the buddhi itself, whatever raga and dvesha, or the sense of agency and the sense of ahankara is there, even that is resolved. Therefore, that buddhi is now resolved into atma tattvam. That atma chaitanyam is mahatah param. Mahatah param. So, mahatah param dhruvam. Dhruvam is kotastha nityam. Na prithivyadivata apekshikam nityam. That is what Bhashyakara says. Earlier adjective says nityam. In the same mantra you have two adjectives. One is nityam, another is dhruvam. If both are not used in the same mantra, then you don't have a problem. Just one word is used good enough. But when both are there, you have to make a small distinction. When you say atma is nityam, morning I have mentioned, you may get a doubt whether is it kotastha nitya or is it the second kind of nitya, pravaha nitya. The answer is, it is kotastha nitya, because dhruvam means kotastha nitya. It fixes that it is not perennially eternal. It is eternal as the source of everything from which the entire universe has come. So kotastha nityam dhruvam. So this is the Brahma, that kind of Brahma, param dhruvam, that kind of Brahma or atma. That's why Bhashyakara said brahmatmanam, because the adjectives, they just coincide either for atma or Brahma. This is a very interesting thing. Whatever adjectives are used to describe atma are used for Brahma. For example, in Gita, ajo nitya shashvatoyam puranah. What is that? Atma. Ajaha nityaha shashvataha puranah. How do you know it is atma? Nahanyate hanyamane sharire. Its association with the body is under discussion. So when body dies, it doesn't die. Now you tell me whether it is atma or Brahma. It is atma. Brahma is the word which is used to represent or to refer to the same principle when it is presented as the cause of the entire universe. Then the word Brahma is used. But when it is presented as nahanyate hanyamane sharire, while the body is destroyed, yet that is not destroyed, then it is not Brahma, it is atma. So that atma, what are the adjectives? Ajaha, nityaha, all these adjectives. Shashvataha. Here also you have Shashvataha. So Nityaha, Jaha, everything. So Brahmatma, that is the best combination. The Brahma is Atma. So such Brahmatma Nichaya. So a person who has understood it with all these, this is how that Brahmatma is understood, Nichaya. Nichaya means having understood. So Nishchayena, with a certainty of knowledge, you have understood it. That is Nichaya. Nichaya Mrutyu Mukhat Pramuchyate. You see, you have to understand Ishvara correctly. Once I have seen two people fighting with each other. Do you know what is the cause of the fight? Very interesting thing. One is saying that Lord Shiva is the supreme authority of this universe. And the other person is contesting it, that it is not Lord Shiva, it is Lord Vishnu who is the supreme authority. They are fighting really. You see, this is what is called ajnana. So they are fighting about Ishvara. What kind of Ishvara? The Ishvara, the way they understood. On that basis they are fighting. So they have not understood. Had they understood, they would not have fought with each other. Because it is the Ishvara who is the truth of the Shiva that this fellow is talking about, and also who is the truth of the Vishnu about whom that fellow is talking about. So two people are fighting about Ishvara because they have not known Ishvara. Had they known, they would not have fought at all. In fact, in one place, they were doing Gokulashtami. Gokulashtami means Sri Krishnashtami, the birth date of Lord Krishna. And on the dais, Rama's photograph or some that murti, that idol was there on the dais. And then they started saying, how Rama's can be there, remove it and put Krishna's.
So they distinguish between Rama and Krishna. They are doing a big program and a festival like thing in the name of Ishvara. I appreciate that much, but they have not understood Ishvara, because the fact that they have tried to make a difference between Rama and Krishna shows that they have not understood it. So lack of understanding of Ishvara can lead to so many aberrations in the behavior of people. Therefore, one has to have a proper understanding. Without understanding, you will make all sorts of mistakes. So, a person who has understood it, mrutyu mukhat pramuchyate, he will be saved from the jaws of death. Mrutyu mukha. And who is telling this word? Mrutyu himself is telling. Therefore, you can take it as a real authoritative statement. He will be released from the prison. Suppose this sentence was uttered by the minister of prisons, the secretary who is in charge of the prisons, or the judge who is in charge of the prison. Suppose he says it, then you can rest assured. Yes, the release from the prison is certain. Similarly, Lord of Death says, mrutyu mukhat pramuchyate. Such a person is not going to be bothered by me. I will not be able to do anything for him. Because you know, what is this mrutyu? Mrutyu is identification with idam is mrutyu. In fact, in Mahabharatam, in also Mahabharata and also in one Upanishad, one vachyam is there. Pramadam vai mrutyu maham bravimi. Pramada, mrutyu means the fall of the physical body. I don't consider it as real mrutyu. Real death is not that. Because fall of the physical body is not such a significant thing. It happens anyway, let it happen. A thing which has to die will die anyway. That is not a problem. But while living, you do not perform your duty. The dereliction of duty, that is what is called pramada, that is mrutyu. That is, in my opinion, that is mrutyu. Suppose there is a father, I failed to do my duty, and I see my son in a shambles, his career is spoiled, he is a spoiled brat, because I failed to do my duty. Then what happens? What does it mean? It means that is the death of the role of the father. The role, father role, it is dead, duty is not done. So when you fail to do the duty, you have killed the role that you have to play. Suppose in a drama, the person goes onto the stage and he will not play the script. He tells all sorts of things. I told you, the villain, once he was hit by the hero, and the villain became so angry and he hit it back. Who are you to hit me like that? So then the hero, he became unconscious and he fell on the dais. Now, then the director came and told the villain, my dear God, you have destroyed the role of villain. You have killed the role of villain. So that means what? You have killed the villain. So he is supposed to play a role and he killed that role. He spoiled it beyond repair. So similarly, if you fail to do your duty, that is what does it mean? It only means that the role, a duty is associated with a role, and that role you have not played. That means you have killed that role. That is the mrutyu really, not fall of the body. Suppose a grahastha is there. A grahastha, his life comes to an end. It's not a big deal. But an atithi, a guest, comes to his house and returns without taking food or empty-handed. That is the mrutyu. There cannot be any other mrutyu, greater mrutyu than that. That is the mrutyu. So pramada means dereliction of duty. That is one thing. Then another way it is understood, avidyahi mrutyuhu. So that is with reference to karma, the duty consciousness based definition of mrutyu. Now knowledge based definition of mrutyu, what is that? Avidyahi mrutyuhu. You see, suppose a person says, this object which is before me, I need it. Without it, there is no life for me. With it, I'll be happy. They say, this kind of kamana is mrutyu. An intense desire is mrutyu. How desire can be mrutyu? Because desire is born out of avidya.
It has come out of ignorance of Atma Swarupam. Atma is Purnam. So you assume that Atma is incomplete, and also that is one assumption which is wrong. The second assumption is by acquiring this particular object, Atma becomes complete. What a folly. Atma is incomplete and then it becomes complete by purchasing a Maruti car. That kind of an assumption or a conclusion, that is avidya and that is murtyu. Avidya hi murtyuhu. Because I tell you, idam is kalpitam. Idam is this jagat, it is mithya, it is kalpitam, it's a setup. I tell you. Do you know what is a setup? Setup means a situation is created, it is not real. That is a setup. So the entire world is a setup. It is kalpitam. And that is one kalpita. And your tadatmya with it is kalpitam. It is also not the tadatmya, you are saying this body is me. That is not a reality. It is a mithya, it is. You are understanding wrongly, it's a delusion, it is not reality. Therefore, in the kalpita dvaitam, tadatmya bhranti, so they are the words, Sanskrit words. But I will be translating into English also. In a plurality setup, identification, a delusion of the identification, satyatva bhranti, that it is the real, a delusion that it is the real. This is the murtyu. There is no other murtyu really. You are having a date of birth and you are afraid of death and you will die only by identification, by false identification with the body. Otherwise, Atma has no birth, Atma has no death. When the bulb comes, when the bulb glows, it is not that Atma has born. By when you put the switch, it is not that electricity is born. When you put off the switch, electricity has died. No. Electricity was there even before Thomas Alva Edison or Tesla discovered it. And suppose by some reason the entire universe disappears, even then electricity will be there in this Karana Rupa, Maya Shakti Rupa. In Ishvara it will be there. Therefore, when electricity has not taken birth, when bulbs come on, or it doesn't die when bulbs go away. Sun doesn't take birth in the morning. He will not die away in the evening. With reference to us, now sun should have died, but no, he did not die. Sun never dies. Atma is like that. Atma Chaitanyam, it doesn't take birth and it doesn't die. You have known the truth, then there is no death for us. Therefore, what is death? A false identification with the body, mind, sense complex is death. So by knowing the Atma Swarupam, a person comes out of that avidya, that is the Murtyu Mukhat Pramuchyate. Bhashyakara says, Murtyu Gocharat Avidya Kama Karma Lakshanat Pramuchyate. That avidya and kama, that is karma also added to that to fulfill that kamana. So that is how the Murtyu is defined. From that Murtyu, the person has come out, he is released. Very wonderful mantra. Next. नाचिकेतमुपाख्यानम् मृत्युप्रोक्तम् सनातनम् उक्त्वा श्रुत्वा च मेधावी ब्रह्मलोके महीयते. नाउ वी हैव कम टू द एंड ऑफ द प्रथमाध्याय. देयर आर टू अध्यायास इन दिस उपनिषद. We are now in the end of Prathamadhyaya. Are we halfway through our course also? Something like that, right? So more or less it is going in a proper way. Okay. Four more weeks. Okay. Nachiketam upakhyanam. Yeah, 4 weeks more. So we may have to speed up a little also probably. We can do that, no problem. So this upakhyana, this is story. You see, akhyanam means a big story generally is called akhyana. But upakhyana means small. Upa means small. Upakhyana. In Bhagavata, it is all upakhyanas, all stories. Dhruva's.
ప్రహ్లాదోపాఖ్యానం దే కాల్ ఇట్ కుచేలోపాఖ్యానం ప్రహ్లాదోపాఖ్యానం డిడ్ యూ నాట్ హియర్ లైక్ దాట్ సో దే సే లైక్ దాట్ ఎవ్రీవేర్ ది వర్డ్ ఉపాఖ్యానం ఈజ్ యూస్డ్ బట్ వెన్ యూ కమ్ టు రామాయణ జనరలీ దిస్ వర్డ్ ఉపాఖ్యానం డజంట్ కమ్ బికాస్ ది రామాయణం స్టోరీ ఈజ్ నాట్ ఉపాఖ్యానం సమ్వేర్ ఇన్ బిట్వీన్ సమ్ అదర్ స్టోరీ ఈజ్ టోల్డ్ బై అ రిషి టు రామ దట్ బికమ్స్ అన్ ఉపాఖ్యానం బట్ నాట్ రామాయణ స్టోరీ సిమిలర్లీ ఇన్ మహాభారత స్టోరీ ది బేసిక్ ది మెయిన్ స్టోరీ ఈజ్ నాట్ ఉపాఖ్యానం ఇట్ ఈజ్ ఎ బిగ్ ఆఖ్యానం రియల్లీ బిగ్గెస్ట్ ఆఖ్యానం ఇన్ ది వరల్డ్ రియల్లీ దేర్ఫోర్ ఉపాఖ్యానం ఈజ్ ఎ స్మాల్ స్టోరీ దిస్ ఈజ్ ఎ స్మాల్ స్టోరీ ఉపాఖ్యానం ఐ టెల్ యూ స్మాల్ స్టోరీ రైటింగ్ ఈజ్ ఎ వెరీ బిగ్ థింగ్ వన్స్ దేర్ వాజ్ ఎ కాన్ఫరెన్స్ ఆన్ స్మాల్ స్టోరీస్ ఇన్ ఇండియా సో స్మాల్ స్టోరీ ఇన్ తెలుగు లిటరేచర్ దట్ వాస్ ది కాన్ఫరెన్స్ దే హ్యావ్ ఇన్వైటెడ్ మీ ఫర్ దట్ మై ప్రారంభ టుక్ మీ దేర్ దట్ వాస్ నాట్ ది ప్లేస్ వేర్ ఐ ఎమ్ సపోజ్ టు గో బికాస్ ఐఎమ్ ఏ వేదాంత టీచర్ వాట్ ఈస్ వాట్ ఐ హ్యావ్ గాట్ టు డూ విత్ ది స్మాల్ స్టోరీ బట్ దెన్ ఐ వాజ్ ఆన్ ది డయాస్ సో మై టర్న్ కేమ్ టు టీచ్ టు టెల్ ఎ ఫ్యూ థింగ్స్ అబౌట్ స్మాల్ స్టోరీస్ వేరియస్ పోయట్స్ అండ్ రైటర్స్ రైటింగ్ వేరియస్ స్టోరీస్ దే టోల్డ్ దేర్ పీస్ నౌ ఇట్ ఈస్ మై టర్న్ ఐ టోల్డ్ ఐ నెవర్ రోట్ ఎనీ స్మాల్ స్టోరీ బట్ ఐ నో ఎ ఫ్యూ స్మాల్ స్టోరీస్ డూ యూ వాంట్ టు లిసన్ టు దెమ్ ఐ టోల్డ్ ఎస్ స్వామీజీ ప్లీజ్ టెల్ దిస్ డూ యూ నో వేర్ ఫ్రమ్ దిస్ కాన్సెప్ట్ ఆఫ్ స్మాల్ స్టోరీస్ దిస్ ఆర్ట్ ఆఫ్ స్మాల్ స్టోరీ రైటింగ్ హ్యాస్ కమ్ ఫ్రమ్ they told we don't know it has come from vedas they don't know that so it has veda is the origin veda the apaurushaya jnanam it is the origin it is the source house of a variety of small stories and then I asked them what for you write a small story for entertainment in veda not only entertainment but knowledge that is the purpose So small stories for entertainment means this entertainment is a big industry. In fact, they call it entertainment industry. In fact, I am sure there is entertainment.com also must be available on the internet. So this entertainment is the main thing. Everybody wants entertainment. They don't want knowledge associated with it. But in Vedam, a small story is invariably associated with a message, a knowledge. Very interesting. So that's why Vedic stories are very beautiful stories. So that day on the dais, I told a small story from the Vedas. A small story I told. Then after the entire meeting was over, the public told her that my small story is the top small story. I'm not a small story writer. I told from Vedas, that's all. So the audience, they gave full marks to the story from the Vedas. So this story is, what a story it is, Nachiketa and Yama, what a story, wonderful story. So now the story part is being taken care of. How? Stuti story is over, the teaching will continue, but the story is now it is being summed up, it is brought to a conclusion. So this Nachiketa Pachyanam, this story, small story, in which the hero is Nachiketa. Hence it is called Nachiketa Upakhyanam. It is not called Yamopakhyanam. Hero is not Yama. Hero is Nachiketa. So this story. And this story, it includes a teaching. Mrityu Proktam. The teaching. What kind of teaching? Sanatanam. You see, suppose you teach some physics today. And some physics that was taught some 15 years back or 20 years back, you compare. That all that physics of 20 years back has become obsolete. Now you cannot teach that and say it is all good physics. It is all historical physics. It has no more value now. I tell you, these computers and electronics with reference to that, we are illiterates. We don't know anything about it. We may be literates with reference to various other branches of knowledge, but not with reference to computers. A person who has studied electronics in 1970, he is equal to an illiterate today. Illiterate, I tell you. What all he knows, it is just doesn't have any meaning. In my days, when I was reading a little electronics, we were having diodes and triodes. We were studying diodes and triodes. And I have done a few experiments with diodes and triodes. Draw the characteristics of a triode, that is the experiment. Therefore, take a triode and pass current and get a few points and draw a graph. This is what I have done. That is all the electronics I know. Now, if I want to tell that to somebody, they will laugh at my face. In fact, you have to go to the history of physics or history of electronics department to find out what is this triode. Those valves, they are called valves. They are no more in the market. They are gone. So that kind of a knowledge is different. Why I told all that? This knowledge is not like that. It is sanatanam. At the moment of creation, it has got validity. Today, it has got the same validity. It doesn't change. This is the difference between an apurna vastu, an incomplete thing, or a limited thing, and a unlimited purna vastu. So, in the case of a limited thing, the thing continuously changes, the knowledge changes, it is improved upon. So what was true yesterday is no more valid today, it changes every day. But whereas a purna vastu, it never changes. Atma chaitanyam, it never changes. It is as fresh at the time of death as it was at the time of birth. And also, it continues to be same unlimited purna atma or brahma at the time of annihilation, same as that at the time of creation. Therefore, it is called sanatanam. Sana means sada. Tanam means vistara. Its glory, its reality, its truthfulness is there forever. That is the meaning of sanatanam, that knowledge. And it is in the form of a story. This uktva shrutva. This is all shruti, you know. Shruti means, the word shruti means Vedam. That is the meaning. But it is called shruti. Why Veda should be called shruti? Because it is passed on from student, from teacher to the student through speech, through the faculty of speaking. So how you are learning the chanting of the mantras? He writes on a piece of paper and xeroxes and distributes or what? No. He speaks it out. You may have a piece of paper, all right, for guidance, but fundamentally, he will be telling out, he will be speaking it out. You listen to it and follow it. That is what you do, right? You have to do that way only. In fact, I tell you, you need not know the alphabet. You can learn the mantras. You need not know alphabet. Not necessary. Because alphabet is a symbol for the sounds that are pronounced by you. You have to pronounce the sounds. You know, I was a student of Veda. In Veda, the teacher says, and I hear and say again. The teacher says, Bhadrangarne Vishrunu Yama Devaha. I hear it carefully and then repeat it. I should not make a mistake with reference to the spelling as well as the sound, the swara. Therefore, the teacher enunciates it. You know, enunciation, pronounce perfectly. That is what is called enunciation. So that is how my pronunciation, when I speak, it is influenced by that habit. I enunciate a word. Whereas in English, the way to pronounce is not to enounce. If you go on enunciate everything, that is not the proper pronunciation. You have to speak it in such a way that you are not speaking it fully. That's why art, I say. A-R-T, art. That is how I pronounce. But in the correct English pronunciation, you are not supposed to say R as R, and you are not supposed to say T as T. They don't say both. Matter, they don't say. They say something else. I cannot say what they say. That is my problem. They don't pronounce T completely. Something they pronounce. Very interesting. Similarly, R also. So the words are not to be enunciated. That's why writing acquires prominence than speaking. Whereas in Vedam, the words are enunciated. Every word you enunciate perfectly. And you carefully listen to it. And again you repeat it. That's why it is called Shruti. So the medium of instruction is ears, Shravanam, Shruti.
That is how the word is there.
So, this Shruti means what? I say, you hear, and say, I hear. If any mistakes are there, I will correct. Uktva Shrutva cha. Saying and listening. Only two. Writing and reading, no. Not writing, reading situation. It is pronouncing, listening. And again pronouncing. If a correction is required, I will make the correction. Like that it continues. So, uktva Shrutva cha. Who? Medhavi. Medhavi means a person whose mind is prepared for this knowledge. That is Medhavi. So, the teacher should be a Medhavi and the student should be a Medhavi. Uktva Shrutva cha Medhavi. Therefore, the Medhavi who teaches, Uktva, and the Medhavi who listens to it, Shrutva. Uktva Shrutva cha Medhavi. What happens? Brahmaloke Mahiyate. He enjoys the glory in Brahmaloka. What is this Brahmaloka? You can do it in two ways. Suppose in the process of listening to this story, you develop a devotion to the knowledge and also to that Agni Vidya. You are supposed to develop some respect and some love for this Agni Vidya, because so much description was given. And so when Havan goes on, now you participate in it with a freshness of mind, because you have learnt what it is all about. And also, when you look at the world, you spontaneously identify yourself with the Hiranyagarbha, and you enjoy the glory of the Hiranyagarbha. That is the result of teaching, because once you go through that Kathopanishad and Mundakopanishad, your vision of the world should have undergone a change without a fail. Therefore, you are now, you may not personally do Havan, but you will participate in the Havan. And also you may sometimes encourage it in various ways. And secondly, when you look at the world, when you leave the Gurukulam and you enter into the world, you will have a new vision which guides you in every part of your life. So that vision makes you one with the Hiranyagarbha. That means the life becomes an upasana. Don't think that upasana means morning and evening for 15 minutes you sit in a corner and that is upasana. No. That alone is not upasana. Ekagramana manaha means mind is focused, single pointed. When? Both morning and evening. No, not that way. We are not talking of that kind of a dhyanam or that kind of upasana. That is okay, that is good. In the beginning it's all right. We encourage it. But I am talking about an upasana, a meditation or a contemplation which is there during the entire life, during the total wakeful period. So when you are interacting with the world, the foundation on which you interact is this knowledge, this upasana, this recognition that you are a part and parcel of the Ishvara Hiranyagarbha. So you constantly relate to that Ishvara and interact with the world. So when you do that, you find Ishvara in every particle of this universe, and you are never away from Ishvara even for a second in your life. A person who does that kind of an upasana, that is the real upasana. A person who lives like that, he becomes a jnani in this life itself. Therefore, he becomes a Brahma. Brahmaiva lokaha, Brahma lokaha. So, his status is that of a jivan mukta. Mahiyate, he abides in the glory of the Atma Chaitanyam, which is not different from Brahma. Brahma loke mahiyate. Or, in case you say that he could not gain Atmajnanam due to some pratibandhakas, due to some obstacles. There are obstacles. We will talk about those obstacles later. So, because of strong obstacles, you know, for some people, this prarabdha becomes very strong. I know a gentleman who wanted to take sannyasa. He is crying for that sannyasa. He is craving for the sannyasa in the last 30 years. Till now it did not materialize. This is how it is prarabdha. Then also I know one gentleman who never talked about a sannyasa, and he never even thought about it. One fine morning the world came to know that he became a sannyasi. So prarabdha, it plays a big role, I tell you. Therefore, if there is a very strong obstacle in the path of gaining knowledge in this life, if that a situation is there, then what happens? What happens? This upasana, this vision and this understanding, after the fall of this body, it will take you to the heavens. And there you will enjoy the fruits of this upasana. You are not going to go anywhere near the hell, the so-called hell. You are blessed. Brahmaloke mahiyate. Next mantra. Ya imam paramam guhyam shravayet brahma samsadi prayatashraddhakaleva tadanantyaya kalpate tadanantyaya kalpate iti. Whenever a sentence repeats like that, you may assume that the chapter closes there. It is called abhyasaha. Abhyasaha means repeat. Tadanantyaya kalpate, tadanantyaya kalpata iti. It repeated twice means the chapter is closed. Not only here, in the entire Veda that is the system. So you can quote any number of examples for this. It is the end of the chapter. Abhyasaha, adhyaya parisamapsyartha bhashyakara. So, adhyaya is ending, that is shown there. Now, this knowledge is paramam guhyam. It is a supreme secret, paramam. Secret, because what is the supreme secret? You see, we have these degrees, you know, good, better, best. So, better is called comparative degree. And best is superlative. What is good called? Some name is for it. Normal it is, some normal thing it is. So whatever it is, good, better, best. So, guhyam, guhyataram, guhyatamam. That is paramam guhyam. You can say best, you can say, or supreme good, you can say. Both are one and the same. Suppose good, better, best. Best. Best is what? Supreme, superlative, also good only. Therefore, what is best? It is the supreme good. Like that in Sanskrit also, guhya, guhyatara, guhyatama, or paramam guhyam, which means guhyatama. So, this in Gita, last shloka of the 15th chapter, every day we recite, ya imam paramam guhyam, something like that it comes. I don't remember the shloka. So there also the word guhyam is used. In fact, Rajavidya, Rajaguhya Yogam is there, you know. Rajaguhya is guhyatamam. Guhyanam Raja, Rajaguhyam. Rajaguhyam means the king of secrets. Means what? The king of secrets means it is the greatest of the secrets. That is the meaning. It is nothing to do with the king and the throne. It is the greatest of the secrets. You see, what is this secret business in the first place? Secret means, suppose a village is there. A small information is known to only one person in that village. Nobody else knows it. Can we call it a secret or not? We can call it a secret because only one person knows, nobody else knows. You see, in Indian villages, suppose a person gets a doubt about Dharma Shastra. Dharma Shastra means whether to do this way or that way. This kind of doubts will come. How a child is born in a house. Now, that nakshatram is doubt. Is it the star in which the child has born. So that star, is it a good star or a bad star? Some doubt will come. So who will tell? Good star or bad star? Who will tell? That astrologist, astrologer, he knows it. And there is only one astrologer. So you go to him and tell him, this moment the child is born at this point, at this time. So you tell us it's a good star or a bad star. He will see the timing and he will tell you it's a good star. Good, wonderful. Suppose it's not a good star, he will tell it in so many words, it's not a good star. Then what to do? If it is not a good star, you have to do something. It is called some atonement karma you have to do, some prayaschitta karma you have to do, so that that badness of the star will not affect the life of that child. So they do a havan or some ritual they do. But what ritual has to be done? Again, there is a person who knows the Dharma Shastra. Only one person will be there, not many. You go to him, he will tell. So this kind of knowledge is called Guhyam. So the knowledge of Dharma, what is Dharma? So that we can do it. What is Adharma? So that we can avoid it. This kind of knowledge is called Guhyam, a secret. But Atmajnanam is a superlative secret. So how it is, we will see in the tomorrow's class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om Tatsat Shri Krishnarpanamastu.